In 1 Corinthians chapter 12, and verse 27, it says, ye are the body of Christ, members in particular. God has set some in the church. Now, some means not everybody. God has set some in the church, first, apostles, secondarily, prophets, thirdly, teachers, after that, miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Now, Ephesians 4:11 says that he gave gifts unto men, he ascended. Jesus did. He descended first, but then he ascended, gave gifts. Apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Gifts unto men for the perfecting or the maturing of the body of Christ, the church. Pastors are not listed in this verse in 1 Corinthians, but governments is. The word governments includes pastors. That is the governing of the body of Christ, the local assembly. But in verse 28, 1 Corinthians 12, 28, apostles, prophets, teachers, and then after that are miracles. Well, evangelist isn't here. Ephesians 4:11 has evangelist. But in 1 Corinthians 12, 28, that word miracles includes the ministry of the evangelist. The only New Testament example, other than, of course, Jesus, who walked in all the anointing. John 3:34 says he had the Spirit or the anointing without measure. But other than Jesus Christ, of course, the only New Testament example of an evangelist is Philip. And you can find about him, his evangelistic ministry. You read more about that in Acts chapter 8. He's mentioned elsewhere. He's one of the deacons in Acts chapter 6. But in Acts chapter 8, you can see his evangelistic ministry. Verse 5, he preached Christ. The evangelist is going to want to do that. Verse 12 of Acts chapter 8 says they believe Philip preaching things concerning the kingdom of God in the name of Jesus. Is that verse 12? I'm not looking. So he preached Christ. Verse 5 says he preached Christ. Verse 12 says he preached things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus. That's what we have. That's what he preached. The evangelist is going to want to preach Christ. Now, unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out of many, it says there. If you continue reading in verse 5 and continue on, it says unclean spirits came out. But he didn't preach on the devil. You don't have to preach on the devil to cast the devil out. You don't have to preach on the devil to have a deliverance ministry. He preached Christ. I tell you what, when you preach Christ, the devil will get nervous. And they may cry right out. And you may have to do something about that. You turn on the light, the darkness will leave. You preach Christ and the devil, I mean, when you preach Christ with the anointing of God, according to the word of God, the devil will get nervous. And he'll cry out, and sometimes he'll leave on his own. Other times you just take authority in the name of Jesus. Evangelistically, unclean spirits crying out with a loud voice. And then many, it doesn't say all, but many that were sick of the palsy and lame, taken with palsies and that were lame were healed. Doesn't say all of them, but says many. They believed the things that he said, hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. So the evangelist will do miracles. You show me an evangelist who's called of God, anointed of God, and walking in the fullness of his ministry. And when you show me that evangelist, I'm looking at someone that does miracles. And if he doesn't do the miracles, he either is not an evangelist or he's not fulfilling the call. Or maybe he's not in the place where they accept it. And if he's not, he wants to be. And he'll pray about that. Where do I go? So that, because God's not confused. He doesn't anoint somebody to do something they never have the opportunity to do it. He'll lead them. He'll guide them. Jesus had the anointing without measure, but in his own hometown, they didn't accept him. He could there do no mighty work. But where Jesus went, Matthew tells us in Matthew 4:23, that Jesus primarily did three things. Teaching, preaching, and healing. Teaching is listed first. Matthew 9:35 says essentially the same thing, worded a little bit differently. But those three are listed in Matthew 9:35. And this is the ministry of Jesus. And these same three are listed. Teaching is first. Preaching and healing. All people want their healing. They want to be healed. But too often people aren't listening to teaching. Sometimes they listen to good preaching. Sometimes. But the church world at large today is sadly lacking in the area of teaching. Especially the Pentecostal church, the people that I'm aware of and around. The church world at large needs teaching and preaching. And then we're at the place to receive the healing. I want to call your attention again to verse 28, 1 Corinthians 12:28. After what? Well, the apostle, the prophet, and the teacher were the miracles. Well, that includes the evangelist, because now he's heard the teaching, God's raising him up, and he's going forth. But it also includes the miracles coming from the faith of the people and not the ministry and the anointing of the apostle and the prophet. Because the apostle will do miracles. 2 Corinthians 12:12 tells me the apostle does miracles. 2 Corinthians 12:12, and this wasn't my plan. I didn't prepare this. Don't have any notes. I'm just speaking out of my heart. 2 Corinthians 12:12 says, truly the signs of an apostle. Again, like I said with the evangelist, when you show me an apostle, if he is indeed truly called by God and anointed by God to be an apostle, and he's walking in the fruitfulness and fullness of his ministry, he will do miracles and signs and wonders and mighty deeds. Truly, the signs of an apostle were wrought among you with much patience, signs, wonders, and mighty deeds. The evangelist will do miracles. The apostle will do miracles. These often are not entirely because of the faith of the people. Now, it will include that because Jesus often would ask people, do you believe that I'm able to do this? He would say, your faith made you whole because you've believed it's done to you. But there are other times, like in John chapter 5, he would heal somebody. And in John 5, that man didn't even know it was Jesus. Well, there are gifts of the Spirit that will operate as the Spirit wills. They will operate. They can operate through anyone in the church, but they should operate through the apostle because he's called to go. In Romans chapter 15, now, the word apostle is not mentioned there, but the heart of the apostle is demonstrated when Paul said, I preached not where Christ was named, lest I build upon another man's foundation. The apostle, when he has the heart of an apostle, the calling and the anointing of the apostle, he wants to go where Jesus Christ has never been preached. That's why he's listed as first. In 1 Corinthians 12:28, God has set some in the church first. God is building his church. Jesus is building his church. Jesus is the one who builds the church. And he wants the glory of the Lord to cover the earth as the waters do the sea. He wants this gospel to go forth into all the world. That includes people that have never heard of Jesus. Now, Paul's an apostle to the Gentiles. By contrast, Peter was an apostle to the Jews. They hadn't heard of Jesus. They haven't accepted Jesus. They need the apostles' ministry. Building the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, not the church of Moses. So Jews believed in the law of Moses, and they need now to believe in Jesus Christ. So there's an apostle that's sent. Peter was an apostle to the Jews. Paul was an apostle to the Gentiles. They've never heard of Jesus. Some of them have never even heard of Moses. Or they knew that they couldn't participate because, after all, they're Gentiles. So that's where Paul goes. Well, in Romans 15, did you put that up? He said, I preach not where Christ has been named, because I didn't want to build on anybody else's foundation. That's the heart of the apostle. And that's why in 1 Corinthians 12:28, it's first. God has set some in the church first. Who's he going to send first into the world? Well, the one who's equipped, the one who's anointed, is the apostle. Because the apostle can do miracles in the presence of people that have never heard of Jesus before. Now, you'll teach and you'll preach and you'll have healings. The apostle signs, wonders, and mighty deeds. Some of it is because people believe the preaching, but they're hearing the preaching for the first time. More is required and more is expected as you grow. But when you're hearing the preaching for the first time, you'll have more signs and wonders. People will believe the preaching. Sometimes gifts of the Spirit will operate whether they believe it or not. I've been there. I told one lady one time, I was prompted to say it just this way. You're going to be healed whether you believe it or not. And she was. And she came back Sunday bringing her friends that she had invited. We were still in that church the next Sunday and the next Sunday and the next Sunday. And she brought friends and relatives because she was telling her testimony. She got healed. I told her, you're going to get healed whether you believe it or not. And she did. But when they do believe, sometimes this is all they've heard and they believe it. God will respond to that. Sometimes gifts of the Spirit will operate. The apostle is going preaching Jesus and he's got the equipment. He's got the anointing. He's got the ability to demonstrate Jesus alive. These signs shall follow them that believe. And you go and you demonstrate that Jesus is alive. It says about the apostles in Acts chapter 4, around verse 12, verse 13, with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of Jesus. Is that verse 12? Verse 12, verse 13, Acts 4, did you put that up? Or is it Acts 5? I want to make sure I have that one. With great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection. That's verse 33. I knew I didn't have it right. Acts 4:33. And with great power gave the apostles witness of the resurrection. Witness means you're demonstrating. You're giving a testimony. You're giving an eyewitness testimony. You are a witness of the resurrection. Well, how do you do that? Well, I'm doing it with great power. The apostles are demonstrating the resurrection of Jesus with great power. In chapter 5 and verse 12, by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders done. Acts 5:12. That's where I got the 12. I merged those together and I said Acts 4:12. That's where I got the 12. Acts 4:33 and Acts 5:12. But on the inside, I knew that's not right. So the apostles are sent first because God's building the church, and that's the one that's necessary first. After that's the prophet's ministry. Then they need good basic Bible teaching. After they hear the Bible teaching, there'll be miracles. Miracles from the faith of the people rather than the anointing of the apostle and the prophet. The evangelist is now going from this new work to outlying areas. He's the miracle worker. He's the evangelist. He's helping with this work and doing outreaches from this new work. And then pastors are being raised up. That's why it says governments. Pastors are being raised up to feed the flock that's coming into the kingdom of God. This is how God's building the church. I think today we have evangelists that maybe for one reason or another, they've decided they don't want to travel anymore. Maybe the spouse decided they didn't want to travel anymore. So they start a church and they pastor their church as an evangelist. And they want outreaches and sinners to come in. Because really that's an evangelist pastoring. And they'll have miracles with new people, but they don't have miracles with the people that have gotten saved and filled with the Holy Ghost. 5 and 10 and 15 years later, they're not having miracles with those people anymore because they're not teaching and they don't have teachers. They're evangelists pastoring. And they're preaching and people love the preaching and the evangelistic flair. And I like that. Sometimes on occasion that'll come on me. I enjoy it. But people like that, they flock to that and they go, well, they don't grow. They enjoy the flair of the evangelistic preaching, but they're not growing on that. They shout, but they don't grow. And people are saved. And then sometimes, now see, the evangelist, Philip, in Acts chapter 8, it says in verse 14, again, I'm just speaking this out of my spirit. The apostles at Jerusalem heard Samaria had received the word of God, said Peter and John, so that they'd come and pray for them to receive the Holy Ghost. Philip wasn't even trying to get them filled with the Holy Ghost. He didn't have that anointing and didn't have that unction. He's not even trying to get them filled with the Holy Ghost. He knows they need the Holy Ghost, but that's not his ministry. That's why we need to operate and work with one another. See where what you don't have and what people need. The evangelist doesn't have everything. Sometimes pastors, if he's not a teacher, if he's a preacher, he ought to know that he needs teaching. He can be a pastor and a preacher. He ought to know, I need teaching in my church. Now, if he's a pastor and a teacher, he'll be doing the teaching. Amen. But we have people today that are not growing. They're staying with the evangelistic flair. And they'll only have miracles with new people coming in. How many of you have seen that? The new people come in, they have a healing. They have a miracle. But somebody that's been saved for 5 and 10 years, they don't get. They come for prayer, but they don't get it. They come for prayer, but they don't get it. They come for prayer, but they don't get it. Because it's after the teaching you have the miracles in this area, in this area. Jesus had the anointing without measure. We have the anointing by measure. That's why earlier in chapter 12, it says, to one is given, to another is given. All these worketh that one of the self same spirit, dividing to every man severally as he wills. So the Holy Ghost has been apportioned. In a sense, and using the King James terminology, it's been divided. Divided. The Holy Ghost anointed has been divided. Somebody said, I have Jesus. I have it all. No, you don't. Well, he's on the inside of me. I can do everything he did. No, you can't. And see, that comes across and it sounds good and people shout amen. And they go out believing that. And then sometimes they'll try some things and fail and fall and get disheartened and discouraged and sometimes even backslide. Well, that doesn't work because they told me I could do everything and I went and tried. It didn't work. If Jesus is on the inside of you, you have the Spirit of Christ, but the Holy Ghost anointing that comes upon, Jesus was born of the Spirit. He was born alive to God. He is the life of God when he's born of Mary. And the very first day he's alive, he's the Son of God. Before he was born, he was the Son of God in her womb. Is that right or not? But it's when he was 30 years old that the Spirit of God came upon him. So when he's water baptized with John, and John saw the Spirit of God descend upon him in a bodily form, just like a dove would, just like a dove would. John said, that's how it looked to me, like a bird would be flying and coming upon you like a dove. I saw the Spirit of God come upon him. And I heard a voice. This is my son in whom I'm well pleased. And from that day forward, well, first he went into the wilderness to be tempted. He was tempted of the devil. But he came from that time of temptation, the Bible says, in the power of the Spirit. In the power of the Spirit. And the first miracle he did was after that. He didn't do any miracles until the Holy Ghost anointing came upon him. He's the Son of God at age 25, but he didn't do miracles. He's the Son of God at age 26, but he didn't open any blind eyes or deaf ears. He's the Son of God at age 27, but he didn't raise up any paralytics or lepers or cleanse any lepers or raise the dead. The first miracle was the wedding of Cana. And that was after the Holy Ghost came upon him. That's why we need to be born again and filled with the Spirit. The Spirit of God within, but the Spirit of God upon. But for us, see, John 3:34 says he had the anointing without measure. We have the anointing by measure. For us, the Holy Ghost is divided. Chapter 12 says, to one is given, to another is given. All these worketh that one of the self same Spirit, dividing to every man sever. Severally means to cut and to separate. One preacher I heard him say, several. I have at least two gifts of the Spirit because the Bible says I have several of them. And I just shook my head. It doesn't say several. It said, and that's the true story. He said that. He's up there on the platform preaching. I know every Spirit-filled believer has at least two gifts of the Spirit. I have at least two because the Bible says we have several. And I just shook my head inside. I didn't do it overtly. But sever means to cut and to separate. So the anointing has been separated. Well, I can do everything. I have the Son of God on the inside of me. I have the Spirit of Christ. I can do all things. I can do all things through Christ that's called me to do. What he's called me to do, I can do. I can do what he's called me to do. I can do what he's called me to do. I can do what he's called me to do. I can do all things that he's called me to do through Christ who strengthens me. That's what Paul meant in Philippians 4. But I certainly can't do everything. In fact, in John 5:19, Jesus said the Son can do nothing of himself. Why didn't he quote that verse in Philippians 4:13? He said the Son can do nothing of himself but what he sees the Father do. Well, what I see the Father do is according to the anointing that he's given me, how he's equipped me. Teach it, preach it. When people believe it, it'll flow. Teach it, preach it. When people believe it, it'll flow. If you have it, now, if you don't have it, it won't even flow then. Not through you. It can come by faith in the word. I think that's what some people are doing. They're teaching it and preaching it, and people have faith in the word. It still didn't come from the anointing of the person because he doesn't have that anointing. But when you have the anointing, it still flows when people hear about it and believe it. In Mark chapter 5, the woman that had the issue of blood, it says in verse 25, she heard of Jesus. So she heard somebody, maybe a testimony sharing some of what Jesus was teaching. So it's come into her ears. What he's teaching, what he's doing has come to her. And she believed it. People have to believe it. We need to get the word out. We want to get the word out. We want people to come, but when they come, we want them to believe. It may not work just because you believe it, but you still want to invite them. You want them to come to hear the teaching, to hear the preaching. And then when they believe it, it'll flow. It'll work. This woman heard. I'm thrilled when people hear it and believe it, but I'm often amazed when they hear it and just don't believe it. And you can tell they don't believe it because they don't do it. They don't talk about it. They don't act on it. But I'm thrilled when they believe it and when they act upon it and receive it and we give praise to God. But the woman heard of Jesus and she came in the press because she said, if I do that, I'll get healed. Press means difficulty. She came in the press because she said, if I do this, I'll get healed and I'm going to do it. I tell you what, I'm going to do it. If I get there and he touches me or I touch him, in fact, I'd rather he not even know I was there because I'm not even supposed to be there. I've got a issue of blood and I'm considered unclean by the Levitical law and I'm not supposed to be around people. So I'd rather he not even know I was there if I could just sort of slink in and slink out, you know, just sort of covertly touch the hem of his garment without being found out. But if I can do that, I'll be healed. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it. She came and touched him. I believe she thought she could do that and not be known. And yet when she touched him, Jesus stopped right what he was doing. You know, I guess he just stopped in his tracks. He's walking. He just stopped and asked, who touched me? And she's probably thinking, oh, no, I'm found out. Because she was fearing and trembling. Came down, fell down before him and told him all the truth. Fearing and trembling. Daughter, be of good cheer. Your faith healed you. Your faith did it. But be of good cheer. Your faith did it. Now he said, who touched me? Because he knew virtue had gone out of him. That virtue is the anointing. That virtue is the healing power. She released it and drew it into her and drew it out of him with her faith. It seems to me that he didn't really have anything to do with it, except he's anointed with it. He's prepared. Romans chapter 12 says to wait on your ministry. He that ministereth, let him wait on his ministry. Stay prepared, stay ready. These things won't operate in a carnal Christian. They can wane. Amen. There's a place where you might need to fast and pray to have that. Paul told Timothy, don't neglect the gift that is in you. You don't want to neglect that. He said to Timothy, stir up the gift. There's things that you can do. When you have the anointing, whatever the anointing is, you can do things to wait on your ministry and to keep it stirred up and not neglected. Stay in the spirit realm. So Jesus is there, ready, prepared, walking, and she touches him, and he knew in himself virtue or the anointing had gone out of him. She felt in her body, she was healed and made whole of that plague. God has set some in the church. We didn't finish reading that, but in verse 28 and 29, keep on reading, healings is included. The healing anointing that Jesus had is in the church today. Gifts of healings, working of miracles, gifts of the Spirit, the gift of faith, working of miracles, gifts of healings, the power of gifts are in the church. But this is a healing anointing. Acts 10:38 says God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. The Holy Ghost, the gifts of the Spirit, and the anointing. The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me to preach. But the healing power is also there in Acts 10:38. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and power. And that's healing power because he went about doing good and healing. Gifts of the Spirit, the anointing to preach, teach, preach, heal. The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me to preach. It says in Luke chapter 4, verse 18. But also the healing anointing is in Jesus. Well, that healing anointing is in the church. God has put that in the church the same way he put it into Jesus. Not without measure, but there is a measure of the anointing, and that measure can be increased. There are some services where we'll have a stronger anointing than in other times. Some services, there will be a stronger corporate faith than at other times. But that anointing is in the church. Now here Jesus hadn't preached. And there was no corporate faith because the disciples didn't even know what was going on. And Jesus is just walking along. And somebody touches him. That's why he said, your faith did that. I've had that where people touch me and I didn't even know why they were touching me. And I feel it leave me and go into them. Sometimes they'd fall. After a service. But during a service, you're laying hands on 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 10 people and more. Depends on where you are. A large church, in one church, it was hundreds of people laying hands on them. And you lay hands on one and there's nothing. Lay hands on another. Seems like you got a hold of a live wire and it just flows right out of you. Well, I would do that to every person if it was up to me. But the faith of the person, the faith of the individual says, I believe the teaching, I believe the preaching, I believe the anointing, I'm going to draw it out. I'm not waiting on God to put it in. I'm not waiting on his faith to put it in. I'm going to draw it out. I'm going to draw it out. I'm going to draw it out. And I'll receive my healing right now in Jesus' name. And then sometimes you don't feel it. You believe that it's there and you maintain the anointing with your faith. And it might be the next day, the next day, or the next day before it materializes. It might be 10 days later before it materializes, but you knew you received it. You felt it go into you, and you knew you had it. And it can be perceived by the senses. She felt in her body she was made whole, but he knew the anointing had left him. Well, you can know the anointing goes into you and your body not change right away. But the anointing's in me. I received the anointing. I felt that. I mean, I talk about Barbara sometimes. She said it felt like warm honey. Well, that's in there. That's in there. God has set some in the church. These things are in the church. They operate the way these things operated through Jesus and in Jesus. But today they operate by measure. He had it without measure, but it's still in the church. These things are in the church. These things, these manifestations, these demonstrations, these operations, these gifts, these workings of the Holy Spirit are in the church today. Can you say amen? Amen.